Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us this morning on your couch, in your PJs, at your house, wherever you're on your computer, or your TV, on your phone. Wherever you're at right now, I want you to stand. I want you to lift praises to the Lord this morning. I know we're going through a lot, but we can still praise Him. Amen.
Is decided I'm not giving up. Cause you won't give up on me. You won't give up on me. Your love is holding on and it won't let go.
Our scripture today is from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 19 through 23, from the New Living Translation. That Sunday evening, the disciples were meeting behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. Suddenly, Jesus was standing there among them. "Peace be with you," he said. As he spoke, he showed them the wounds in his hands and his side. They were filled with joy when they saw the Lord. Again, he said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you." Then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven."
The last time we spoke together, we were talking about Jesus' conversation with Mary at the tomb. The final words to her were to go and to tell the disciples, "I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." And then our scripture goes on to today to talk about the disciples being together in an upper room, in the upper room there, in that room. Now, it's interesting that the disciples probably were the original group that started practicing social distancing. They stayed as far away as they could from anybody because they did not want to go through what they had just seen with Jesus. They didn't want that kind of persecution. And all of a sudden, Jesus comes and stands among them. And then Jesus commissions them for their new ministry. The ministry begins. And then Jesus says to them, "My peace I give to you." Now that expression is a normal welcome in that day for the Jewish people. That would be like saying, "Hey, how you doing today?" They would say, "The peace be with you." But this is a little different. When Jesus is saying this to them, he is talking about his Messiah's peace. He's talking about how this is different. And remember, the disciples were probably a little concerned about how when they saw Jesus come in, they probably thought there was going to be some censure or rebuke or something because of the way they had acted just that day, a few days before. But Jesus says to them, he's giving them his peace. He's offering to them the Messiah's peace. Jesus again is calling and referring to that scripture we read in the 14th chapter of John, where he says, "My peace I give to you." He goes on to say, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." He says to us that we are not to be troubled. Now, even today, when we think about what's going on, when we think about this situation, this pandemic that we're in, many of us are troubled by that. I listened to a show over the few days ago, and they talked about the fear that most people in the mental health community are having because of all the concern there is with the anxiety and the depression and the post-traumatic syndrome that's going to come through all of this that we're going through. And God wants us to know right from the beginning that we do not need to be troubled, that he is going to come and he's going to calm our troubled hearts. Jesus goes on in that to tell them, when he says, "My peace I give you," not only do you not have to worry about your troubled heart, but you know that my peace is there for you. You do not need to be afraid. You and I can stand confident in Jesus Christ, as those first disciples did, knowing that Jesus says to us that we have his peace. We do not need to be afraid. This peace of Christ is a redemptive work that takes place and achieves for the disciples and for us this inner sense of peace, this inner sense of rest in our spirits. Jesus' peace is what he wants us to know as a fellowship with God the Father. He wants us to know that with him, we are with the Father. We are together in one, and we do not have to be afraid. We do not have to have a troubled heart. And then Jesus goes on to them and says, "See my wounds." He wants them to see that he is alive. He was a man. Jesus the man had died, and now Jesus the man was alive. He stood there. He wasn't a ghost. He was a real man in a real body, and he wanted them to know that he was risen. The reality of Jesus' death was very real to all of these believers. Jesus had told them he was going to die. They knew all of this was going to take place. Now Jesus stands right in front of them, and he says, look at the wounds. Feel my side. Touch me. Know that it's me. Know that I am alive. Without saying anything, he's reminding them that what we talked about in the I am statements, I am the resurrection and the life. I am here. I am alive. I am this for you. When the disciples realized this, they became filled with joy. They felt that everything, that their fear had begun to wane, and their joy was to become complete. They felt being drawn closer and closer to Jesus, seeing him alive, seeing him resurrected, seeing him answer all those questions they had had about getting to this point, removing all those things that kept them not believing in Jesus Christ. And Jesus says to them that he is there for them. Today, just like the disciples, we need to seek out Jesus' presence. We need to know that Jesus is with us. We need to know that he's alive. We need to look at his side. We need to touch him. We need to feel the nail prints in his hands. We need that spiritual touch to Jesus Christ. We need to pay close attention to who he is and what he has for us. We need to see that he is the resurrected Lord. And then we need to rejoice in his resurrection and rejoice in the power of his resurrection. And then, I don't know how to say that right. There's supposed to be this funny way you say it, and I guess I'm too old to know what that is. But if Doug were up here, he could say it perfect. And Bob and Taylor and Victoria, when we did this worship planning, we decided to do this, and then they all had that down perfect. The old man, and then, or however, I don't even want to try to say it, because the more I try, the more embarrassing it's going to be. So we'll just go with this. And if you know that, how that and then goes, you can say it at home, and you can make fun of me for not knowing how to say it. But once we really realize who Jesus is, once we see who Jesus is, the scripture goes on to say to us, the and then of that is that we need to be Jesus. Jesus goes on and he says to the disciples and he says to you and me, I am sending you. He is calling us to step out. He says, as the Father has sent me, I am sending you. The disciples and each of us need to realize that scripture. Each of us need to have the same, see that we have the same commission. The Father has sent me, and I am sending you. That's the same thing. We're just like Jesus. We get to be Jesus. We get to step out and do the things that he's called us to do. Jesus' commission to the faith community was to continue the work that God had sent Jesus to do. We all wonder, we've heard that scripture where Jesus says that we're going to be able to do much more than him. And most of the time we say, oh, that'll never happen. You know, Jesus says, if you say to that mountain, move over there, it's going to move. And we say, no, no, that can't be. And Jesus reminds us right here. Jesus says to us that just what God called me to do, I'm calling you to do. I'm calling you as the faith community to step out and to be the people that God has called you to be. Now, we know that the disciples needed God's help to carry out this commission. It was very difficult. And if you think about where they still were, you had people that were denying Jesus. All of them ran and hid. None of them stood up for him. The women were there, but the men all took off. John was maybe with, you know, far enough away that nobody could recognize him. But all of a sudden, from that day just to this time when Jesus comes to be with them, 3 days later, he says to them, you know what? You got to step out and be me. So you know they didn't think they could do it. And then Jesus says something and does something for them. Jesus says to them that he's going to give them the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. So the scripture says that they received the Holy Spirit as he breathed upon them. He breathed that upon them and they received the Spirit. Now we know that the Spirit had not really been given previously because Jesus' body had not been glorified. This glorified Jesus, resplendent in his resurrection body, poured out the Holy Spirit on these followers. It foreshadows the arrival of the Spirit's empowerment at Pentecost. This is the precursor to what's happening. They had the power of the Holy Spirit in them. All it had to do was wait till Pentecost where it could be released, when they were ready for that to be released. Now you think there's some time we're going to keep doing this and then. And we know all that Peter did at Pentecost. And here Jesus breathes the power, the Holy Spirit's power into him. But there hadn't been that reconciliation. There hadn't been that restoring of Jesus to Peter. Next week we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about how Jesus restores his relationship with Peter. But at this point, they have the Holy Spirit breathed into them. They have this power. Now, I almost thought about cutting the scripture a little short and not using this 23rd verse because it can be really confusing. It says this, if you forgive anyone's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Now, I thought some of us couldn't deal with that. Some of us might think, geez, I have that much power? I can decide who's forgiven and who's not forgiven? Well, the truth of that is, yes, you can. But it's a little different than what you think. God doesn't forgive people's sin because we do. Nor does he withhold forgiveness because we do. God says to us that rather than those who proclaim the gospel are in effect forgiving or not forgiving their sins, forgiving other sins, depending on whether the hearers accept or reject Jesus Christ. Remember, our ongoing work of Christ followers parallels, like I said, the work of Jesus Christ. We are to be like Jesus. Now, I know that you in that verse, it talks about us being responsible for the forgiving of sins. If we don't go out, if we don't share the gospel, if we don't talk to our friends, if we don't have times like this where we reach out to the community in Christian love, if we don't show people that we are Jesus' disciples, how will they ever know about Jesus? How will they ever know Jesus' forgiveness and Jesus' love if we don't tell them? We follow Christ's prompting through the work of the Holy Spirit, just as Jesus obeyed his Father. You and I are so important to the work of Jesus Christ. Jesus fills us with his Holy Spirit, sends us out to do the work of God, sends out the faith community. Jesus comes to his people, gives them peace, shows them his resurrection body, and then he sends them out. And then Jesus commissions us. Remember, the ongoing work for us is to follow Christ, is to be Christ's followers, and it parallels the work of Jesus Christ. We come alongside others the way Christ came alongside us. We build a loving relationship with others. We listen and we serve. We show them the Father. And then our mission begins. As we have our time of prayer and time of offering, I would like you to think about your offering to Jesus Christ, how you become Jesus Christ, how you do the same work Jesus does. Jesus, called by his Father, now calls you and me. That's the offering that we make, that we step out and do what it is God has called us to do. Let's pray together. Father, as we come to you in worship and in our tithes and offerings, we pray that you would just bless us, that you would help us to know that we are called to do the work of Jesus Christ. We thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for his restoration in our lives. We thank you for your showing us how to be the community of faith. Be with us, bless this church, and bless each of us, and draw us closer to you, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief.
Sing it with the church.
I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
In the middle of the storm, God will.
together, there's going to be healing in this nation. Sing this out with me.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail.
Sing it out.
Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory.
promises. God, thank you for your mercy and your grace. And then we know that you're there for us in these times of need. We love you and we praise you. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
We just heard that he never fails us, that we're still in his hands. God calls the community of faith from those first disciples right up to us today to know that in the hands of Jesus, in the hands of God, we can step out and we can bring salvation to others. What we do, how we live, how we represent Jesus Christ is what will lead other people through the power of the Holy Spirit to believe. You and I, people that continually fail, people that continually fall short, are in the hands of Jesus. And we're like tools in the hand of a master. And he is using us to build his kingdom. May we step out with faith, knowing that he's never failed us yet. For we ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go and spread the salvation of Jesus Christ every way possibly that you can. For we ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God bless you and have a great week.